The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Come, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer. Come on, shake your body, baby, do that conga. No, you can't control yourself any longer.
Nobody could see it was there. Somebody thought maybe it was really curled up inside the lid. By the end of the day, I had the most unbelievable, whopping, fiery conjunctivitis I've ever experienced in my life. And going along with that was an intense photophobia. So that's why I decided to be Ray Charles today. If there were no lights on in this room, that would be great. In fact, when I woke up this morning, I thought there's no way I wouldn't be able to look at any light today. Because even when I got in the middle of the night, which old people often do, and you just kind of look at the glow on the dial of your nightlight, it was like, you know, being hit in the head with a sledgehammer. But the fire is gone, the photophobia is a little bit better, and what I thought I was going to be coming here today to make the announcement that there'd be no class and we'll make up for it some other time. But what I think I'll do instead of this, I think I'll give it a try. You know, we were very close to the end of our discussion of immune diseases. So what I think we'll do is finish it up. There's not going to be too much left, okay? We have to finish a few things about AIDS, and then we have to have a kind of an in-depth discussion about amyloidosis. If things are going good and my sight is still holding out, then we'll do the lab. Now, I don't think I can be looking directly into that computer there, so I've asked Francesca to help me out and operate the microscope if we get to the lab part. Okay, well, normally I don't like to make excuses for why I can't do this or that, but today is a pretty unusual day. We'll see if we can make it work. And I know it's working for online, so let's start out where we left off. In fact, Francesca, can you actually change it from here? Because I think I'll be looking into the dimmer screen there rather than looking at into the computer here. It'll make my eyes feel a little bit better. Okay, here we were about over here approximately. Yeah, here this is where we left off. Thank you very much. I'll probably have to take this too. Yes.
Is
there
a sign in the sheet or no?
A what? Yeah, a sign in the sheet is rolling around. It started there. I think it still might be there. There's not too many people today. Okay. Here's your sign in the sheet. Very nice to sign in today. We were talking about the 9 genes that HIV has, and just kind of explaining how almost all of the things, all of the structures, all of the anatomy, all of the proteins, all of the enzymes, all of the functions can pretty much be coded by those 9 genes, even though some overlap is present. So, what we'll do now is just talk a little bit more about it. Because we've kind of scurried around the whole issue of AIDS and went a lot into the epidemiology and the structures. Let's talk about the disease. And I'm sure it's something that you're all aware of, but let's talk about it. Let's do the next one, Francesca. The really, really scary thing about HIV, of course, is that most people that are HIV positive, they don't know it. And that's why this has been allowed to spread, because people are giving HIV to other people without even knowing they have it itself. That's why testing is so important. And let's start out with the virus entering somebody's body. Okay, well, I guess at that point, you could call that the primary infection. And even though we mentioned that there is a whole wide variety of cells, theoretically, that HIV can infect, you all know the prime target is the lymphocyte, the T lymphocyte, the CD4 regulator T lymphocyte, probably the most important of all lymphocytes. I'm going to also try to take off my glasses if I can. You'll soon discover I don't have white in my eyes, I only have red. After a relatively brief interaction with lymphoid cells, the virus basically goes into quiescence, or a latency stage. We shouldn't call it latency at that point, but the actual
clinical expression of the lymphoid infection is like any viral prodrome. And I've been told by real experts it could be a very mild prodrome. It could be not present at all. Now we're talking about several weeks from exposure now. We're talking maybe 6 to 8 weeks. And the typical person may think, oh, I have a little bit of a flu or, you know, stomach flu, got a little bit of a fever, but goes away real fast, or it may be so mild, in most cases, you don't even know that you had it. Or it may be a classical viral prodrome characterized by brief fevers, chills, muscle aches, the kind of things that we all experience before we get what we might call a viral illness or stomach flu, let's say. Well, that's the acute syndrome. And then it goes into a latency period, okay? In the latency period, the virus is relatively quiescent, it's quiet, it's there, it's doing a little bit of damage. But in the latency period, could last for many, many years. Now, if you look at these statistical charts, it looks like it's an average of about 6 or 7 years. But in some cases, now that we're, you know, 20 or so years into the epidemic, it could be a lot longer. And then, in the old days, there were certain specific criteria for what that transition was between latency period and what we would call full-blown AIDS. And there were a set of criteria like presence of certain organisms, you know. Generally, the presence of a major opportunistic infection, you know, like PCP, pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, or Kappa C sarcoma, or cryptosporidium, or candida esophagitis. These were all things which would often appear after the latency period, in which then the diagnosis of full-blown AIDS could be made. Now, there were also lab criteria also. Often it was a number of lymphocyte counts, or CD4 cells. And if they went below a certain number, that would probably be the most solid criteria of what would be then diagnosis AIDS rather than HIV positive. Now that we have viral load testing, we can determine the amount of RNA viral particles in the person's blood that has pretty much displaced the concept of trying to identify the number of CD4 cells. So the criteria between HIV positive and full-blown AIDS are generally not as quite solidly defined as they have been. There's been some changes, but let's just say an HIV positive person, which most likely he's been for years, with the presence of a major opportunistic infection, which probably PCP is the most likely one, is regarded as the diagnosis of full-blown AIDS. Let's go to the next one. Okay, what I have here is something I'm going to have to stray a little bit away from it, but it's not very complicated. What you're looking at here is the virus, okay? If you want to call that PCR RNA presence, it's very, very high in the beginning, you know, in the initial infection. And here's your latency period. Look, that virus is actually down for what, 5, 6, 7 years on the average, maybe more. And then, of course, when it starts going up again, it corresponds to the CD4 lymphocytes going down. At some point, they're going to cross. And probably at this period now, we're going to see the development with the rapid dwindling of the T cells and the extreme popularity of the viral particles. We're going to probably call this full-blown AIDS. Most likely in this area, the patient has some major opportunistic infections. And here's the same thing. Look, once again, here's the virus. You know, that's no big surprise. But just to tell you that some of the antibodies that appear will be appearing, you know, after the initial rise of virus. That's why, you know, the HIV test, no matter what antibody you're measuring, is not going to be appearing right away. It's going to be appearing possibly in the range of 6, 7, 8 weeks following infection and after you've had the major portion of your prodrome. And the general rule, and we'll see this with hepatitis too, is that, you know, there are a wide variety of antibodies that we can measure HIV with, and the general rule is the more superficial the antigen is on the viral particle, the more, the earlier that comes in contact with the host cell, is those are going to be antibodies to those antigens appearing quicker than the ones that are deep within the virus. That's a general principle, and you see that all the time in hepatitis testing as well. Okay, let's do the next one and see if my eyeballs are still holding up. Okay, so what are the actual abnormalities? Clinical and laboratory. Well, you know, a major principle of just about any viral infection is that they seem to have an effect on the lymphocytes, even if it's not HIV. We saw the example of the EB virus causing classical, normal-looking lymphocytes to become atypical. Sometimes you could see proliferation of lymphocytes. Sometimes you could see suppression of lymphocytes. In the general HIV infection, you will see a lymphopenia. Why? Because it's the lymphocytes that are getting destroyed. Now, if you were to actually divide that into T cells versus B cells, even if both of them float around in the peripheral smear, would you think that the T cells would be more selectively disappearing rather than the B cells? Yes. Let's say you could make your test to determine whether the cells that were disappearing faster were CD4 cells, you know, the generals, the regulators, or CD8 cells, the effectors, you know, the foot soldiers. Well, you know that the number one cell is the T cell CD4. So those are the ones that really disappear first, and they comprise a good amount of a general peripheral circulation. So what you see in the lab as a lymphopenia, you know, so if you take, let's say, anywhere from 6 to 10,000 white cells as normal per cubic millimeter, and you know probably about a third of those should be lymphocytes. And if you actually count the percentage versus the total amount, you can get an absolute lymphocyte count. Well, that's going to be the thing that goes down. There are a wide variety of tests that you could do in the laboratory to measure T cell function. So even if the T cells are not gone or not destroyed, they're infected. An infected cell cannot do a job as good as a non-infected cell. So this array of lab tests for the function and viability of T cells, they're abnormal. Now, here's another interesting thing, and most people don't know this. We've seen an example several times already where a decrease in one thing corresponds to an attempted increase in another thing, like when we're talking about the hypergamma M syndrome, or the decrease, the hemolysis of red cells producing a hyperplasia in the marrow. So in a case like that, even though the T cells, more or less selectively, are getting wiped out, they're getting injured, they're dying, you actually often have a sort of activation of the B cells. And it's polyclonal, okay? In other words, it's B cells and antibodies that are not just one specific clone or one specific type. And because of that, I bet you if I asked you the question, what kind of lymphomas are more common in HIV patients, B-cell lymphomas or T-cell lymphomas, on the basis of that observation, you say, well, if the B-cells are proliferating, And that's one of the big factors in carcinogenesis. Remember, that's the promotion effect. Then you probably guess that the B-cell lymphomas are one of the most common cancers that you see in AIDS patients. It might not be as common as Kaplan-C sarcoma, but it's common. In fact, here, let me ask you this question, because we haven't really talked about lymphomas. We haven't really gone into them yet. But if I just ask you in general, if you took all of the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas and you said, well, how many of them are primarily B-cell proliferations versus T-cell proliferations? Well, most of them are B-cell lymphomas anyway, aren't they? And also, even though we have been focusing in on the lymphocyte as the main cell of damage, we've also noted that many other cells are being damaged. And you want to know what the number two cell is? After the T lymphocyte? It's the macrophage. Of course, if the macrophage is in circulation, you call it a monocyte, don't you? If that monocyte decides to go out of the blood vessel walls, they call it a macrophage. So there's abnormalities in those macrophage functions as well. Okay, let's go to the next one. If this slide looks familiar, like maybe you've seen it before somewhere, it's because it is. This is exactly the same slide that we talked about when we talked about infectious diseases, and we talked about the more common infectious diseases to occur in immunocompromised patients. Well, that's what AIDS patients are. You remember the list that we had yesterday of immunodeficiency syndromes, the primary ones? We said, well, if it's a T-cell function, you're more likely to have this. If it's a B-cell function, you're more likely to have this organism or this infection. Well, if somebody was to ask you, what would be a good list of common, everyday, real diseases that you see in patients whose T lymphocytes are being destroyed, you say, oh, all I have to do is you ask any infectious disease doctor what are the most common opportunistic infections that AIDS patients have. So here they are. And interestingly enough, the most common ones are not really bacteria or viruses overall. Probably the number one thing is PCP. Even patients that are not positive with full-blown AIDS yet carry that little bug around in their lungs. This is an organism that we never even heard of before there was AIDS. Oh yeah, we would have sporadic rare reports. Now, it's the number one pneumonia of AIDS patients. A patient comes in that's been HIV positive for years, and he goes to the emergency room, he has a pneumonia, maybe the radiologist will call it woolly or cotton wool infiltrates. Well, the general rule is that's PCP until proven otherwise. Then there may be a biopsy done, or he may just be treated other ways without doing the biopsy. And the pathologist will use the term cotton wool edgy. But now he's not talking about radiologic, he's talking about the fact that the alveoli are filled up with a fibrinous, cottony type of material. And if you look really close, it's almost like in the middle of that little fibrinous material, you see almost like little brown type of things. When you stain those with the fungal stain, the silver stain, the most common of which is methenamine silver, then you got these little bent coins all over the place. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, you told us that PCP was a protozoan, and now you're telling us it stains positive with the fungal stains. So make up your mind, what is it? Is it a protozoan or is it a fungus? Well, it's a protozoan classified, but it's probably the closest thing to a fungus that you could imagine. Now I know they're technically different, but the staining features of that protozoan are similar to what you will see in fungi. Cryptosporidium. It's a bug we've all been exposed to. I wouldn't be surprised if you turned on the water this morning in your faucet, drank a glass of water, or like me, maybe made a little punch out of it, a little crystal light, I would not be surprised if there was a few little cryptos for you. We know how to handle it. Our immune system can handle those few little bugs, okay? AIDS patients can't. In fact, here, I'll give you a statistic. Diarrhea in an AIDS patient is cryptosporidium until proven otherwise. Very, very, very common. Well, it's making me feel like I shouldn't be sipping my punch here, but... Okay. And once again, everybody still calls it PCP, or pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. Someone along the way decided to change the carinii to JRBC, and if I just call it pneumocystis carinii, there's always one student that comes up to me who's got an A in micro, and they say, oh, well, isn't that called JRBC now? And I go, yeah, but you know, I'm just too old to change. And it's still generally called PCP. Toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasmosis is not a very common disease before the AIDS epidemic. You know, that's another protozoan, isn't it? Do we see a pattern here? Protozoan, protozoan, protozoan. In fact, let me give you another statistic. I may have mentioned it before, but if an AIDS patient comes in and they have localized neurologic symptoms, and for some reason all you suspect a brain tumor, and sure enough, you get a CT scan or MRI, and there's, you know, a localized lesion there, increased signal, so you know there's a lot of edema around it. There's about a 50% chance it's toxoplasmosis. Before the AIDS epidemic, nobody ever heard of toxoplasmosis in the brain of a young male, an adult young male. And I said 50% chance that it's toxoplasmosis. What do you think the other 50 is? You think a regular brain tumor? Probably a CNS lymphoma. And that's another really, really weird thing again. Before the AIDS epidemic came around, if you were to go up to any pathologist, any of my buddies, and you say, hey, have you ever seen the primary lymphoma of the brain, of the central nervous system? He'd probably say, well, maybe one, or he'd probably be really honest and say no. Or maybe he'd say, oh, I saw one at a conference one day. But, you know, they didn't really exist. Now, half the AIDS patients that walk in with space-occupying lesions in their brain, if it's not going to be toxo, it's going to be a CNS lymphoma. And do you also remember we said when we talked about fungi that in general fungal infections were the most, generally speaking, present in immunocompromised patients? Well, no exception here. You know, probably the number one fungal disease, you know, candida, present in many people who might have the immunosuppressed disease called diabetes, for example. What do you think that's going to do in somebody that's as severely suppressed as somebody with HIV? Nocardia, salmonella, there we finally got a bacteria. Oh, we got another bacteria, we got tuberculosis. Tuberculosis, caseating granulomas, and especially the mycobacterium avium, which is an atypical mycobacteria. It's not mycobacterium tuberculosis. These are very, 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 very common infections. These are the significant opportunistic infections whereby if the HIV person has one, it's good presumptive evidence. You can no longer call them HIV positive. You have to call them full-blown AIDS. Another thing is candida esophagitis. That would be the classic. That was a classical major thing. If somebody has an esophagitis, well, a lot of people can have an esophagitis, you know, there's reflux. But if you if the GI guy did an endoscopy and you actually found some fungi on there, and it turned out to be the most common fungus that affects non-keratinized squamous mucosa, 90% of the time, Canada, that you no longer had an HIV positive patient, you had somebody with full-blown AIDS. Last but not least, this big, big, big family, we're finally into the viruses now. In fact, up until now, we didn't really have any viruses, did we? So if you were to wonder, what is the number one category of viruses that will infect an immunocompromised patient, an HIV positive patient, a patient with a severe deficiency of T cells, a patient with a severe deficiency of CD4 T cells, it's all in the herpes family. It's herpes simplex, it's a varicella zoster, okay, also in the herpes family. Remember, red intranuclear inclusion, red intranuclear inclusion, whoops, blue intranuclear inclusion. Okay, maybe we'll have a little bit more detailed imagery of some of the things we just talked about, so let's do it. Next one, PCP. If you think this is kind of a normal chest x-ray because you haven't seen one, I don't blame you. You know, I think a lot of people might call it normal, but the radiologist with the keen eye will say, well, look, these are infiltrates, but they're not really the sort of dense, well-defined. They're more like cotton wool. They're fluffy. I've heard them use a lot of words. And I think cotton is the number one word that they'll use, especially if they know it's an HIV positive patient. So let's say somehow you get at that. Maybe there's a biopsy done. Of course, if it's a patient that's HIV who comes in with this, they're just going to be treating for the PCP. They're not going to be going to do the biopsy. But if a biopsy is done, or if an autopsy is done, and you're looking at the alveoli, and guess what? Can I convince you that this is a pulmonary alveolus, except that doesn't look normal because there's an increase in cells? But how would you describe this fuzzy stuff inside the alveolus? Would you be tempted to use the word cotton as well? I mean, I know we have a general word for anything that's pink and non-cellular. We call it, you know, hyaline. But this is more fuzzy. We might call this fuzzy or cottony hyaline. Well, the pathologist will then, on this pathology report, talk about cottony exudates or infiltrates in intraalveolar. And when you see that, especially if you see the million of them like I have, you know it's PCP. But you might want to do the stain anyway. And if you stain this with the silver stain, remember the silver stain is the big, big, big fungal stain. The PAS stain and the silver stain are the big fungal stains. When you do the silver stain, you see these what has often been called bent coins. I mean, if you don't agree they look like bent coins, that's okay, but that's the phrase that's used. That's absolutely PCP, or if you would rather, PJP. It can't be anything else. Next one. Does this look like it might be a villus, possibly, of a small intestine? Well, it's sort of papillary. You see some connective tissue there. You see some cells. Maybe some of them look like there might be absorptive cells here. Maybe some of them might look like a little bit mucinous. But what's this? Do you normally have these things adhering to the surface of the mucosal cells? And in some cases, perhaps here, and perhaps here, it's, you know, I really be hard-pressed to call it. That's cryptosporidium. Cryptosporidium is not a deeply invasive chromosome. It pretty much stays stuck to the mucosa. But as part of its life cycle, maybe you took, or maybe you saw the actual life cycle of cryptosporidium somewhere along the way. But part of this life cycle is that it doesn't just adhere to the mucosal epithelial cell. And, you know, mucosal epithelial cells are either going to be absorptive in function or mucinous in function. They'll actually go in superficially, and that's part of their life cycle. By the way, this is a little bit offline, but what do you think is another extremely, extremely common pathogenic organism that is known to adhere to GI mucosal epithelial cells, not really invade very much, but just kind of hang along the surface? Does anybody kind of remember? You're close. What's the bug that causes almost all duodenal peptic ulcers?
H. pylori.
H. pylori. Same kind of thing. They're not deeply invasive, but they do adhere. So if you want to stain for this or do some special tests, you're not going to be looking in the core. You're going to be looking around here. These are some good examples. These are all that. They do more than they do a little bit more than just adhere. They'll actually have some superficial inclusions. Okay, let's see if we have anything else you want to talk about. Only because this is so important, I've showed you this at least once or twice before. We said the general rule is that granulomas, I think that was one of my test questions, wasn't it? That granuloma has four kinds of cells. It has generally the epithelioid cells, which are also called macrophages, or the pathologists are called histiocytes. Some of them fuse to become giant cells. There seem to be a little cuff of lymphocytes as your third cell. And then the older it is, the more likely it's to have fibroblasts. And of course, if the whole thing is fibroblastic and coagulous, they call it a healed granuloma. It can also calcify too. So you take your granuloma, and if you think that in this granuloma, you are losing cellular definition by just having crumbly necrotic type material, you can call that caseating granulomas. And the general principle is, you know, caseating granulomas are tuberculosis until proven otherwise. Because the other common types of granulomas, for example, like sarcoid, is usually not necrotic or caseating in the middle. Let's do the next one. Cancers of AIDS. Well, I think everybody knows that one of the big presentations of full-blown AIDS is sarcomas. Hemorrhagic, skin lesions. Also, once again, hardly ever seen in this country, very, very rarely, sometimes seen in Africa, even way before the AIDS epidemic. And now, a very, very large percentage of HIV-positive patients, when they develop the hemorrhagic lesions, you may have seen them on people you know, is Kaposi sarcoma. If it's a vascular sarcoma, you would think that the cell of proliferation would have to be an endothelial cell, right? Otherwise you couldn't classify it as a malignancy of blood vessels. So if there's a stain that would specify as a marker for usually the blood vessel tumors, like factor VIII, maybe endothelial cells, then you could identify it that way. But remember, what causes Kaposi sarcoma? Well, is it the AIDS virus itself? Yes, it's in the herpes family, isn't it? So as an example, we've told you, so far that makes it the fifth herpes type virus besides, you know, HSV, VZ, CMV. Now we got another herpes virus taking effect in an immunocompromised patient. B-cell lymphomas, we've already opened the door for that. I don't know what the mechanism is, but I could theorize it. If almost all of the malignancies of lymphocytes, called lymphomas, are B cells in AIDS patients. But they are, well, the vast majority of lymphomas are B cell anyway, like 75-80%. But in AIDS patients, it's almost all of them. Does that mean the virus is in there causing it? Probably not, certainly not directly. But what it means is that there is a proliferation of B lymphocytes to make up for the lack of T lymphocytes. Remember we called it polyclonal?
Well, you remember the three things that I heard Dr. Jalan say here about 10 times in the terms of oncogenesis? You have to have initiation, you have to have promotion. And what was the third thing? Probably spread. I don't know what the word he used. But this is a factor for the development of lymphoma, because when you have polyclonal proliferation of B cells, that's promotion, isn't it? Last but not least, not only are the herpes family viruses the viruses of choice for immunocompromised AIDS patients, they're also the viruses which are the chief causes of malignancies and benign conditions of squamous cells. So cervical cancer, okay, well we all know that cervical cancer is an STD, even though it's a neoplasm, we all know they're generally caused, and we said 16 and 18 were like always the two biggest ones that are indicted. I think Dr. Jalan mentioned a couple more, but I like to narrow it down to really the two most common. So squamous cell proliferations, whether papillomas, carcinomas, whether they're the cervix, whether they're squamous cell cancer, whether they're precancerous type lesions, are probably going to be much, much more likely HIV positive people. Okay, are we done? Oh, we got a couple more slides here. And it's only three slides, but it's an awful lot of material. And you may have heard of the concept of amyloid already. And you know that's some kind of buildup of some kind of crazy protein that occurs in some conditions. Well, you may ask yourself, well, why should we be talking about buildup of this crazy protein in a chapter on immune diseases? Well, and the answer for that is amyloid, a protein. And the reason why it's called amyloid is starch also has the word amy in it, right? And they say something, amy is a root word for starch. You say, no, if it's starch, that's a carbohydrate, isn't it? So why would you call it a protein? Well, in the early days, it turned out that this protein just happened to stain very, very simply in the lab with iodine. Remember what happens when you put iodine on a potato? That's something starchy. It turns a very intense, specific bluish, purplish color. Well, that just happens to be also the way this thing stained, can stain white chalk. Amylase, right? Isn't that an enzyme that breaks down starch? So amy is the root word for starch, but it's a protein. And the most common form of amyloid, well, there's three forms, but by far the overwhelming most common form is called AL, amyloid light chain. Well, where have you heard the term light chain? Because does that mean it might be a buildup of immune proteins, you know, light chains from immunoglobulins? And the answer is yes. So when you have amyloidosis building up in organs, you know, like a heart, a spleen, a liver, anywhere in the walls of blood vessels and the kidneys, it's going to be a proteinaceous substance. And if you look at its structure very carefully on the electron microscope and you break it down, you can ultimately see that it looks like it's generally a very compact stacking of portions of immunoglobulin molecules, which are rich in light chain. That's by overwhelmingly far. That's also the one that stains most consistently with Congo red, because I remember somewhere along the line, you were told that Congo red is a fairly easy and a fairly specific stain to identify amyloid. And of course, if you put Congo red in amyloid, it's gonna be red. That's why it's called Congo red. But if you then use polarization,
of that red substance. It's going to then be green. And some people call it apple green. If you look at the literature, some people actually call it granny apple green. Because we all know what the color is of a granny green apple. And it's going to show quite brilliant on polarized light. It's getting apple green violet fringes. There's a couple other types of amyloid. They both stain with the Congo red stain, but there are some forms of buildup of amyloid which are generally non-immunoglobulin protein. It's not nearly as common as this. And of course, we all heard of beta amyloid, didn't we? But even though we haven't given you the big discussion on Alzheimer's disease yet, you know that's one of the big things that builds up in the brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so we have this substance called amyloid, and for some crazy reason, it builds up. And some of the reasons aren't crazy. Some of the reasons are very logical. For example, let's say that you have a massive buildup of immunoglobulin because you have a multiple myeloma. Well, you think the multiple myeloma patients are at a very, very high risk of developing amyloid? Absolutely. Also, in granulomatous diseases, there is a polyclonal buildup of immunoglobulins. So most likely, the people with chronic granulomatous diseases, like TB and fungi, are also at high risk for development of amyloidosis too. But do you want to know without a doubt what the most common likelihood is, or the most common setting for buildup of amyloid? I'm going to have to tell you the answer, but I'm not going to let you answer. It's just old age, okay? If you do very careful studies, you see that amyloid is always present. I wouldn't be surprised if you have a little bit of it yourself, but when you get to be 30 years older than what you are, like me, you're probably going to have, you know, five times as much. Okay, and that's independent of whether you have Alzheimer's disease or not. It's very common as just a buildup of material and aging. But just like atherosclerosis, you have a buildup of material in the arteries with aging. You know, you have risk factors, but after you separate all that, the older people have more atherosclerosis, they have more atheromas, they have more cholesterol. Well, they have more amyloid as well. Now, we compared it to atherosclerosis. I have something I feel very obliged to tell you about. You might say, well, we know you can get amyloidosis in the spleen, we know you get it in the liver, we know you get it in the kidney, we know you get it in the lung, we know you get it anywhere, we know you get it in your connective tissue. But really, where does it really first start to build up? And the answer is in the walls of blood vessels. Very often, when you have what should normally be a 150-gram spleen, and all of a sudden it's 500 grams, and you look at it, or maybe it's bigger than your liver, and you look at it and you say, oh well, it seems like most of that stuff is amyloid, because I don't see any cellular detail. I just see this glassy hyaline, and I did my Congo red stain, it's all amyloid. Well, believe it or not, when it very first started to build up, maybe many years ago, it started in the walls of blood vessels. That's why if you ever suspect amyloid in your patients, and sometimes the cardiologists suspect it when they see a big heart that's non-hypertensive, and they're thinking maybe the guy has cardiac amyloidosis because it's producing the kind of arrhythmias which are very often seen with cardiomyopathies. And that patient might wind up getting a biopsy in general, even if the rest of his organs aren't too big. Of course, they're not going to biopsy his heart. So a very common place to go is just a biopsy, you know, some abdominal subcutaneous fat. And invariably, there's going to be a few little blood vessels there. And it's a good place if they start to see the beginning of a buildup of amyloid. It might be very small. Then it'll kind of support the thing that this guy's myopathy is due to amyloidosis. And hopefully, you can confirm it with your Congo red. But very often, if you really, really want to confirm it, you'll do electron microscopy. I can remember you always remember your mistakes. I remember when I first started practicing pathology, I did a very, very good renal biopsy, and I did a very, very good Congo red stain, and it was negative, and I told the doctor, Barry Heft, I even remember his name, because it was my stroke. I told him it was negative. And he goes, yeah, but you know, we also send the biopsy to a lab that did the ultrasound microscopy, and they found some amyloid. So remember, the sensitivity for looking at those little fibrils on the electron microscopy is much, much greater than if you do a Congo red stain. Any organ you can think of is a candidate to develop with amyloid, but I'll give you a little tip, because I had a relative that may have died of it. If the amyloid doses is quite limited to just one organ, like heart, the rest of them are normal size, or liver, or spleen. If it's just one organ, there's a good chance that that's familial, and there's a genetic component to it, okay? Even inheritable. So a person that has a significant enlargement of one organ and winds up being amyloid, nowhere else, don't be surprised if some of his children wind up getting that, you know, years later. Next one. Okay, this might be our last slide, but it's just something to emphasize. You know, if I could jump up and down 10 times and say big type boards, I would, but I'm a little bit too old for that. Congo red stain without and with polarization. I wish I could make the lights a little dimmer. Here's a blood vessel. You notice the wall is not really uniform. It's redder in areas because it's taking up the Congo red stain. So then you put your little polarizer in the microscope. Remember, it's basically something you put before and after the slide, and you can turn it if you want. Well, you turn it, and you'll actually see an area. Oh, God, this is not good, but maybe you can see it better on your PowerPoints. Because if it's not draining off of reading, you have not confirmed your amyloid doses. If it's positive just as red, then that's very, very, very good chance. But once it polarizes, it's a birefringent apple-green. Oh, you can see this in a few other places. That is amyloid. It can't be anything else. Somebody have a question?
Yeah, it's the one on the right. It's the green.
Oh, do you see the green? I'm sorry, is that it?
Yeah.
Okay, good. That looks like a million year epithelial cell. Sorry, I just can't see today. But does it look, have you ever seen a granny apple? Remember how green it is? It's not the kind of green like you see out here in the hedges or your grass. It's like a lighter green. Now here's my question to you. You have to be very, very honest. With all the granny apples that you've seen in your entire life, would you say that color is pretty close to it? Okay. So then we'll just say, what about if I just said green biofringent? Would that make you feel better?
Yeah.
Okay.
Looks like the turquoise.
Okay. Next one and last one before we take our break. Okay. So we've already said that if the most common form of amyloid was built up of immune protein, then you would say, well, probably the diseases before amyloid that might be at risk for amyloid would be diseases in which you have buildup of immunoglobulins. Now, did you get the discussion on red blood cells and white blood cells? Probably not. But you know, or maybe you don't, so I better define it, that the malignancy of plasma cells called multiple myeloma pours out tons and tons of immune globulins, light chains, and sometimes disappear in the urine, it's Betz Jones proteins. But let's just say that multiple myeloma proliferation, malignant proliferation of plasma cells, is associated with a massive amount of buildup of monoclonal immune protein in your blood. It's monoclonal because they're tumor cells, so they have to be monoclonal, right?
Is that what you call M protein?
What's that?
Is that what they call refer to as M protein?
No. Not from my knowledge. I think M protein is another thing. Monoclonal protein is a specific type of immunoglobulin. It may be gamma G, it may be gamma A, and it's a
associated with both heavy and light chains, and it's very often in the blood at such tremendously increased levels. Did you ever see a serum protein electrophoresis of a normal person? You've got this big spike called albumin, and you got a few little bumps for everything else, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, gamma, okay? Well, very often the gamma is bigger than the alpha. So if you think that albumin is what, 80%, 70-80% of your entire blood proteins, in multiple myeloma, the immune globulin could wind up being the main feature of the main quantity of the serum proteins. So, plasma cell proliferations, malignant multiple myeloma, very often just clinically referred to as dyscrasia. Please don't ask me why. If you look up the word dyscrasia in the dictionary, all it means is something horrible, something abnormal. But for some reason, when you hear the word dyscrasia, you can do a little Google test with this. Most likely, it's preceded by the phrase plasma cell dyscrasia, and that means multiple myeloma. That's the highest risk. Chronic granulomatous diseases are associated with buildup of polyclonal gamma globulins. Actually, any longstanding significant chronic inflammatory process may result in buildup generally of immune proteins. TB is at the top of the list, of course, always classical for any chronic granulomatous disease. Hemodialysis. Hemodialysis patients, I don't understand why. I looked it up, but they're often at risk as well. And I'm thinking, well, maybe it's because they're in hemodialysis because they have amyloidosis. But that's not it at all. Most hemodialysis patients are diabetics. And remember, hereditofamilial, it could be very specific. It could run in family. But a hereditofamilial amyloidosis most likely is going to involve one primary organ. If there's many organs, it's probably not heterofamilial. And something that you're going to learn about in endocrine are these so-called MEAs, or multiple endocrine adenomas. And there's a type 1 and a type 2. I don't want to get into them now because they need to be discussed in better detail. But the MEN2s, okay, especially the second type, also go by a variety of regular names as well, is often associated with buildup of amyloid. And can I ask you, where the amyloid is usually present in the multiple endocrine adenomas too? This is really a tough question.
Is it kidneys?
No. In the thyroid. There's a certain type of thyroid cancer called medullary carcinoma of the thyroid. It's not capillary, it's not follicular, it's not undifferentiated, but it's medullary. And it always has amyloid with it. And if you want to remember right now, medullary carcinomas of the thyroid are the single unifying thing to determine the presence of a multiple endocrine adenoma type 2. And we'll be talking about those when we get to thyroid, or when you get to thyroid, maybe. And of course, the most common thing is the last, it's aging. I guarantee you, even at my very, very young age of 64, if somebody decides to really, really examine all my brain arteries or other arteries very well, they're going to find little deposits of amyloid. It'll happen to all of us. I was amazed to realize that many years ago. And they don't emphasize it very much now because even if you live to be 100, the amount of amyloid you're probably going to build up is not going to cause any significant clinical problems. Not nearly to the extent of some another buildup in arteries called atherosclerotic plaque, anyway. Okay, we're done. You know, I'm glad that I was able to make it. The vision here was still a little bit fuzzy, but I really appreciate Francesca for helping me out there. And now it's a question of taking a nice 10-minute break and doing a few lab cases. There were 30 lab cases associated with this chapter, and probably 10 of them are not things I think are really pertinent or not really things that we emphasized
but they put them in there for other reasons. So we'll probably go over maybe 10 or 15 cases quickly and point out some of the salient features histologically of the diseases that we talked about in class. And maybe we'll go back and try to relate those things to the clinical presentations as well.
So let's do a 10-minute break and come on back in 10 minutes. Oh, and by the way, I keep forgetting to say this, but every single one of those cases that we talk about or that we show in the microscope, every single one of them, if you go to Rock Lab and you click on the link, not the slide, but the link, then it'll give you a video of me talking about them in a more organized fashion than just, you know, showing them to you under the microscope now informally. So you have that option too. Thank you, Francesca.
You don't have any normal. But if you say
bone marrow can often be seen in the appendicular skeleton, but usually not in the adults.
And most of the animals, after they use the vascular.
Yeah, there may be some expansion. And there also some increase in cellularity as well. But the normal bone marrow is 50% cell, 50% cell. In my own, it may be 80% cell. In my cell, it will be 12%.
So,
most of the deaths of the most myeloma patients are it's right here. So you could plug in your flash drive. They're called CHMs. Whoops. There it is. It's 12 gigs.
Cool.
Just plug it in after 12.
Okay. I brought my portable hard drive.
Okay, so you've got many gigs on it, right?
Oh, yeah.
Let me ask you a question then.
Yeah.
Are the rights of my life right or wrong?
Right.
I feel 1,000,000% better than I did on myself.
What happened?
There was some probably irritation from the contact lenses. I probably left them in too long. That was the worst conjunctivitis I've ever had. I'm thinking, well, maybe I picked up something exotic on the island here, you know, like chlamydia. Yeah, a lot of people have these little problems.
From what? I don't know. Well, I'm going to have to arrest you.
What's the differential diagnosis of conjunctivitis? What's the main virus? The asthma virus. Well, chlamydia is the number one cause worldwide. Kind of scary. But at least I know I'm getting a little bit better.
Do you think it's better?
I don't want to think about it because I'm going to be doctoring myself if I have a fear for a patient. And a doctor.
Well, luckily, I arrived at the hospital yesterday. The nurse said, I should go. Pretty good. You get an appointment in the morning, and then I'll see you for 2.5-3 hours.
Yep, Colin sent you there?
Yeah.
She tried to send me there, too, I said, no way.
I don't blame you.
I'm going to send you to Oxnard, because I think it's probably the only time.
Yeah. So, the only thing I ruled out is some thermal peritonitis, to make sure it wasn't after surgery.
Mm-hmm. Hey, do me a favor.
Yeah.
When this song is over, from the Blues Brothers, click on the eagle.
I got the little one.
Okay.
We're back, and I noticed a couple of comments from the online people that because I was straying from the mic, they didn't hear me well enough. It's only, I have to be within 3 or 4 feet of this, so I think rather than have Francesca show the slides and me run around again, now that my vision is a little bit better, or at least less painful, we'll just do the lab the way we always do it. And what I did was, if you have been to Rock Lab, hopefully, to check things out, there's about 30 cases related to all of the diseases of immune system that we talked about in one way or another. And probably 10 of them are things I just scratched off the list because they don't quite fit in what we talked about the last couple of days. So we'll have about 20 cases left, and I don't know, depending on how much we talk about each one, some of them just may be very quick demos. Some of them we might want to talk a little bit. And remember, the purpose of the lab is not to teach you how to be, you know, diagnostic pathologists. The purpose of the lab is to help you see exactly the diseases we're talking about during the lecture. And also, if you want to relate it back to some of the other things we talked about, disease, like clinical findings or etiology or whatever, x-ray findings, then I think that's an excellent way of doing it. And that's why I have lab. And when I went to medical school, every single medical school that I knew of had a pathology lab where students had slides and microscopes. And of course, it's evolved now into a lot of the places as virtual microscopes. So nobody has microscopes anymore. They all have computers. And sometimes they're individual computers. And sometimes they're one big computer, which is going to be mine. So I think if you had, you know, 8 computers in this room and everybody was on a different computer, you still don't know, you might not know exactly what to look for, but if there's one guy showing you everything and you're seeing everything at the same time, that's better. And that's why I do this. And
Also, a good number of medical schools, I don't want to say half, but I know it's a really good number, have abandoned histopathology completely, which I think is bad. And usually schools like that, they do things like small group sessions in lieu of, you know, hiring pathologists that know what they're talking about, or even TAs. They now have these small group sessions in which the students teach themselves. And all I can say is, you know, that certainly saves a lot of money for the school, doesn't it? And if they could convince the students that it's better education and the students believe them, then I guess the students think they're getting a better deal too. But you're going to get the hardcore old-fashioned histopathology. And I started out by just putting down the numbers of the cases. And I think we could just go into our big slide box here that says something like histopath FPX. And I know the online people can hear me now. And if you can hear me better than you did the first hour, please say so. Just say yes or something like that. Otherwise, you're certainly free to participate in some of the things we look at as well. Okay, first case in our slide box is K217. So we go past the numbers, and now we go to the alphabets. And here's the K's, I think. And this one looks like 217. So once again, we have a slide. These are not Kodachromes. You know, these are glass slides. They have real human tissues on them. And we're going to put under the microscope, and we're all going to have it focused together for our own eyes. And once again, like all these other thumbnails, you'll see something pink and blue. Okay, and it seems to be bluer in the middle and pinker towards the outside. So you're probably thinking, well, this is probably some organ or tissue that has a lot of connective tissue on the outside and more cellular, maybe even epithelial or whatever on the inside. So the only button I really need to know how to use is the one that says plus, because what I do with that plus button is I blow it up. And you can see I'm blowing up the mid portion, so you know exactly where I'm going. And sure enough, you could recognize this as connective tissue. So whatever this tissue or organ is, you're probably thinking, well, it probably has some kind of capsule. And then furthermore, you all know what these four guys are here. You know, they're blood vessels. Or they may be exactly the same blood vessel cut as it's kind of squiggling around the capsule. And you know, this looser stuff on the outside is fat. And then you see something here, and I'll probably ask you, what do you think it is? And you'll probably, in all honesty, say, I have no idea. And that's because if I was to show you what a normal one of these looked like, which I'm not going to do, you were going to say, this doesn't look like a normal adrenal gland. You say, well, I could see the capsule. I could see these big vascular spaces surrounded by smooth muscle in the medulla. But I don't see your classical thick cortex, you know, the glomerulosa, the fasciculata. Instead, what I see is possibly some epithelial cells, but they look like they also have a lot of inflammatory cells around them as well. Does everybody agree with me so far? This is not a normal adrenal. You can see some little epithelial-like structures. They don't differentiate into the three layers. And there's a lot of little inflammatory cells surrounding them, like there and there. And you know there shouldn't be this many inflammatory cells. So you want to call it chronic adrenal cortex-itis? Okay, you could do that. When we discussed our big array of autoimmune diseases, I said there were many, many, many more. And do you remember a guy by the name of John F. Kennedy? Do you remember the disease that he had of his adrenal gland? Addison's disease. So what is Addison's disease? Would you like to put Addison's disease on our long list of autoimmune diseases? Remember, in every autoimmune diseases, we talked about a normal cell or a normal antigen or a normal tissue being attacked by either antibodies or cells or both. And what if I was to tell you that Addison's disease, which is the most common cause of adrenal failure in adults, is another autoimmune disease. And that's why you don't see much of an adrenal cortex here, but the part that you do see has a lot of inflammatory cells around it. So would you like to call this autoimmune adrenal cortex-itis? Sure you can, because that's a proper definition of it. It was actually listed in the ROC lab listing, which is not my words, it's from the University of Iowa, as primary chronic adrenal insufficiency. It's also called Addison's disease. And when we get to the chapter on endocrine, we'll go into it more. But I want you to remember for now that Addison's disease is another autoimmune disease in which your own cells are attacking antigens present in your own adrenal cortex. Relatively spares the medulla. And we'll go back slowly now so you can see the big picture again. You know, one of the students, I don't know who it was, but they used the term big picture, and that kind of stuck with me. Because a lot of times when you learn things in medicine or pathology, you're looking, zipping up at the cells and the molecules, and you're just not going back to the big picture. Like, I think you actually said something about we'd like to see the big picture in immunology. Did you say that yesterday? Or is that somebody else?
I said about it.
Well, in my opinion, what I consider to be the big picture is the picture that I showed you three times. And it's a definition of the MHC. Because to me, that's where all of immunology starts. And if you want to go back even further to that little segment of chromosome 6, you could say that that's the really the big picture. So it's an adrenal gland. It's infiltrated by inflammatory cells. There's no organism in that adrenal gland causing the inflammation. It's strictly another autoimmune disease. So when I had all those localized autoimmune diseases on a list, you know, like Hashimoto's and autoimmune, yeah, and I told you there were a lot more, well, this is another one. In fact, let's say it again. Any inflammatory disease in which a external pathogenic organism cannot be clearly identified is suspect for an autoimmune disease. Okay, so you have a suspect now. What do you do to prove it? We don't want suspects. We want guys that are in jail. We want red hot, you know, airtight cases. Well, you prove it by identifying antibodies in that suspected disease against the patient's own tissues. And that turns a suspected autoimmune disease into a bona fide autoimmune disease. Okay, let's do another case. And the next case I thought was cool. It was also listed alphabetically as 3299. And 3299 looks like it's going to be somewhere. Whoops, right here. Okay, so once again, we got something that looks like it might have a capsule on it and some fat around it. And in the middle of it, those wide open vascular spaces again. Remember the central veins of the adrenal medulla. And then we got something that looks like it's symmetrical, you know, a capsule here, a capsule here. What if I was to tell you this was another adrenal gland? Of course, you'd believe me because it looks like an adrenal gland, sort of. So here's the question. What is wrong? I'm drawing that little box now from the capsule all the way to the medulla. And look, it's sure enough. You can see little groups of epithelial cells right under the capsule. They look glomeruloid or like little balls. So maybe that's the zona glomerulosa. Maybe that's the zone of the adrenal gland that secretes the hormones involved in salt regulation, like aldosterone. But in all honesty, do you really see much by way of cellular definition beyond that? And I'm going to zip it up even more. I'm going to get your capsule here, and I'm going to say, yeah, well, look, I could tell these are sort of like epithelial cells, but look, as you go deeper, you'll still see a few isolated cells, but the main picture is a glassy, homogeneous, eosinophilic substance, and we know that the pathologic name for that is hyaline. And we know hyaline could be fibrous tissue, we know hyaline could be fibrin, we know hyaline could be buildups of proteins, carbohydrates, it could even be amyloid. So let's say that you're working this case up and you want to prove that that's fibrous tissue. That's a big scar of the adrenal. Well, then you would do a trichrome stain, right? And all this stuff, this hyalinized stuff between the cells, would be green, wouldn't it? But let's say the trichrome stain was negative. And you're thinking, you know, it looks sort of like it might be amyloid. So what if I was to tell you that you did the Congo red stain and this pinkish general stuff was now really red? And furthermore, you got out your little Radio Shack polarizer, your little filters, and you start polarizing it, and bingo, that red area turns to green. You got your diagnosis. In this case, we have amyloidosis replacing most of the adrenal gland. And look, we're going from the capsule, which has fibrous tissue. And by the way, if you did your trichrome stain, the capsule would be green, wouldn't it? But this stuff wouldn't, because it's not collagen, it's amyloid. So let's slide it down a little bit more until we get to the medulla. And look, it's almost all hyalinized, eosinophilic type stuff. And then look, are we back here? You see, those are your big vascular sinuses of the adrenal medulla, you know, for quick, fast pouring in of epinephrine into those big vascular sinuses. And then we're going now from the reticularis to the fasciculata, all the way back to what you might recognize as little round glomeruloid cells. Except for one thing, you don't really see fascicles and you don't really see a reticular pattern, because that architecture seems to be completely destroyed by these infiltrates of hyaline material, which we proved were amyloid. Would this most likely be alpha amyloid light chain, or non-immunoglobulin amyloid, or beta amyloid? But most likely alpha. Light chain alpha. Okay, let's do another one. How about, oh, you're going to love this one. This is kind of a trick case. K202. Here's the case. Here's 202. Okay. So, once again, we got something that looks like it has a capsule. It looks like there's fat on the outside. Let's go in a little bit deeper, like let's say an area like this. And sure enough, there look like there's little glomeruloid structures underneath the capsule, maybe the zona glomerulosa. And then we have more straight or fascicles. Like if you were to take some of those palm leaves outside, you might call them fascicles because they're generally linear. And if you were in the jungles of St. Lucia, maybe you'd see a reticulated python with more of a crisscross reticulated pattern. But you can see more of a fasciculata here, and you see glomerulus. You know, this is adrenal again, and you're thinking, well, why the hell is this guy showing us all these damn adrenal glands? This one doesn't look like there's amyloid in there. It doesn't look like there's a lot of inflammatory cells in the adrenal. But every good person is very, very thorough. And if you're trying to look into that adrenal and find some abnormal histology, I'm telling you, it looks like a pretty normal adrenal. But remember, we said the capsule is fibrous tissue, and often there's a few little blood vessels around the capsule. Well, what about these blood vessels here? Let's take a look at them. So we're going to blow up the Michigan and Minnesota here. And you go, whoa, these blood vessels don't look normal. They look like there's a lot of inflammatory cells around them. Do you agree? And with all the blood vessels that you've seen in histology, they normally don't have infiltrates of inflammatory cells around them, do they? So let's blow it up even more. Sure enough, those are inflamed arteries. So the process here is not anything that looks terribly bad in the adrenal itself, but in the artery surrounding the adrenal. Now, what if I told you that many arteries were involved? What if I told you we could go back to adrenal now and look in other areas like here and here, as well as here and here, and there's multiple arteries, poly. And let's say that we found out that there's multiple inflamed arteries in other places of the body. Do you think polyarteritis would be a good diagnosis? Or let's say that some of these arteries were so inflamed, they actually had kind of a nodular pattern. Do you think polyarteritis nodosa would be a good name for this disease? Have you ever heard the term before, by the way? You don't have to. We'll be discussing that in the thing on vascular diseases. But what if I was to tell you that polyarteritis nodosa, or if you prefer the term periarteritis nodosa, because it seems like the chief inflammatory infiltrate is at the edge or peri in the adventitia, even though, look, you could even see some inflammatory changes in the wall here. Let's say you want to call it periarteritis nodosa rather than polyarteritis nodosa. That's okay, because it's the same thing. What if I told you that almost all of the primary inflammatory diseases of blood vessels, in this case arteries, you could not find a specific identifying infectious pathogen? I don't care what you do. Do PCR, do cultures, do anything you can. They're all negative. That means that most of the arteritides, the primary inflammatory diseases of artery, are also autoimmune. And, you know, maybe I'm just not up to date, but I bet you if you want to do a little bit of a Googling job, you're probably going to find somebody that has found some type of antibody against some facet of this artery. But do you also remember what we said about systemic autoimmune diseases in general? Is that they very often have some type of abnormality on an ANA pattern? And do you remember one of those patterns? I think it was speckled, but I might be wrong. Is very often positive in the systemic autoimmune disease of periarteritis nodosa. And if you're questioning the fact that why should it be called a systemic disease if it only involves arteries, well, don't arteries have intimate relationship with, you know, every organ of the body? So the primary arteritides, of which poly or periarteritis nodosa are at the top of the list, are also autoimmune systemic diseases. Oh, here's another great one. In fact, it's not only going to be great, it's going to be easy. And this is going to be case number K295. So let me squint my eyes and find the K, and then look for 295. And it looks like that's going to be about right here. Okay, does this look like something you might have seen before? Does anybody want to take a stab at it, either in the classroom or online? Does somebody sort of immediately recognize the tissue? Does it look like a cerebellum? Does it look like central nervous system? Do you remember the granular layers, the Purkinje cells? This is a cerebellum. These are folia of the cerebellum, just like you would call them gyri or of the cerebrum. Well, the little gyri of the cerebellum are called folia, aren't they? And these are your granular layers. And to tell you the truth, I forgot the names of all the granular layers, and I bet you have too. But I think I can convince you that if you look very closely at some of these guys, it looks like central nervous system. You see a lot of cells there in the white area with little halos around them. So you know those are oligos. You know that most of these things are probably nerve fibers. You know this is white matter because there's no neurons, and also because most of the cells are myelin-making cells, the oligos. That's why it's white matter, because it's myelin. Here's a little blood vessel. So we're being very, very nice at pointing out the normal features of cerebellum or nervous tissue in general. And then we kind of look a little bit closer at this little vascular or meningeal area between the folia, like here. And you're saying, well, yeah, this is probably just some leptomeninges, you know, vascular tissue. But look, there's some little lumpy nodules there as well. So let's blow one up. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, if you can't tell me what this is, I'm going to be really, really sad, because we've seen these so many times already. Multinucleated giant cells, epithelioid cells, lymphocytes on the outside. It's a granuloma, isn't it? And furthermore, when you look at the inside of this granuloma, you can still see good cellular detail. It's not necrotic. It's not crumbly. It's not friable. It's not caseous, like the crumbliness of cheese. So what are non-caseating granulomas doing in the brain? Well, maybe there's some infection. You know, we know that TB can infect the brain or anything. We know that fungal diseases can infect the brain or anything. We said that sarcoid was on the list of granulomas, but they're not caseating. We also said foreign bodies are frequently associated with granulomas. So that's the question. If this is non-caseating and you have your four classical causes of granulomas, TB, sarcoid, fungi, and foreign bodies, what's your most likely diagnosis? I'm waiting for an answer because, you know, I'm feeding it to you. And feel free online, because I know you probably know what it is. You ever think, well, sarcoidosis, somebody figured it out. It's not just in the lung in young black women, is it? It's a systemic disease like tuberculosis. This is sarcoidosis of the cerebellum. And you're thinking, well, you know, what the hell does that have to do with immune diseases? Doesn't this belong to another chapter? Well, remember when I told you that whenever you have an inflammatory disease in which you can't identify a specific causative organism, it's generally going to be lumped in the category of autoimmune. Well, we know that fungi cause fungal granulomas. We know that Mycobacterium tuberculosis causes TB granulomas. But what organism causes sarcoid granulomas? Is there a sarcoid virus or bacteria or acid? No. So I think the reason why they put it in as an autoimmune disease is because sarcoidosis does not have a specific infectious causative agent. Okay. Let's skip that one. Let's go to 4721. I don't know about you, but I'm having an awful lot of fun here. And I'm hoping that you're picking up a lot of things as well. So 4721 is our next one. And it's going to be easy. And it's going to be right here. 4721. Bingo. okay, well, what do you think this is? Well, it's some kind of connective tissue, right? And you can see a blood vessel there, right? And what else can we do? Well, let's go to high power. Real high power. Well, look, a lot of those cells look pretty thick, like there might be some kind of muscle fiber, but the nuclei are in the middle of the fiber. And what if I was to really zoom in big here and I could show you some striations as well? I hope I can, but I can't. So this is skeletal muscle. I'm sorry, this is striated muscle cardiac type, isn't it? So big deal. So you got a heart. 95% of the heart is skeletal, cardiac muscle anyway. But what else do we have here? Let's go down. Let's go down. Well, look. Not only do you have these fibers, but look. You can have areas between the fibers, even in large groups like this, in which there's very little cellular material. And it's red. It's pink. It's homogeneous. It's hyalinized. So I think, well, that must be a scar. The guy probably had a heart attack, and that's a scar. So let's do a trichrome stain on this stuff, and we're going to show you that it's scar tissue, and we're just going to say it's an area of fibrosis secondary to a heart attack or something else. And the trichrome stain is negative. So what's the next homogeneous pink eosinophilic material you might want to prove that it is? Amyloid. And really, amyloid is one of the very common things that will cause enlarged hearts or cardiomyopathy in the absence of hypertension. And guess what? So you do your Congo red, it's red. You polarize it, it's green. So you got your diagnosis. This is cardiac amyloidosis. And let's go down a couple of notches here and move it around. And you can see some of these amyloid areas are really pretty big. And look, there's a gigantic one over there. And they just seem to be... Now, can I make a suggestion here? Let's take a look at part of that amyloid area and a few of the fibers below it. If you did a trichrome stain because you thought this was fibrous tissue, but it wasn't, do you think that this area here might be some fibrous tissue between the cardiac muscle cells? It looks like it's a little bit different in texture and staining from the amyloid area. So I suspect this is collagen and that's amyloid. But it kind of looks similar under the microscope, doesn't it? That'll stain positive with trichrome, that'll stain positive with Congo red, but not vice versa. Okay. How about... Oh, you're going to really like this one. And it's easy. And it's something we talked about at pretty good length. 4243. 4243. Well, once again, it looks like it's some kind of connective tissue, right? And at this point, you really can't say much more than that. So let's blow it up. Let's say at least the middle portion. And you say, yeah, it's kind of like fibrous tissue. There's blood vessels inside of it. There's a vessel, there's a vessel, there's a vessel. But it also has a lot of these little nests of lymphocytes or chronic inflammatory cells. And furthermore, it's sort of thickened. It's sort of fibrotic as well. And then you go to your histology book and you learn that synovium is basically just two cell layers thick. There's one synovial cell and then there's a macrophage-like cell underneath it. And you go, whoa, this is a lot thicker than two cells. And furthermore, there's a lot of chronic inflammation in it. And thirdly, I bet you there's a lot of fibrosis as well. So what would be the most likely disease to cause significant, whopping chronic inflammation and fibrosis of synovium. It's rheumatoid arthritis, isn't it? Because rheumatoid arthritis is a primarily a synovitis. But we said it was systemic. So do you think this guy may have a vasculitis as well? Do you think this guy may have lesions elsewhere? Do you think this guy may even have skin lesions? Absolutely. So let's just say you got a synovium here, and you have to believe it's synovium. But if you took synovium from any other part of the body, that's normal. You would never see this much inflammation and this much fibrosis. Okay. I got something here that you're really going to like. K-187. And it relates to something we just said. So now you're looking at the most boring thing you've ever seen in your life. It just looked like it's pink. Doesn't look like there's much to it. And if we blow up the surface, I think I could convince you that it's skin, because you can see a stratum corneum here, and you can see the rest of the layers here. So it's, if it's not skin, at least you'll believe it's keratinized stratified squamous mucosa, which is almost always skin. But, and if you saw some skin appendages like hair or sweat glands, then you would absolutely know it was skin. Oh, but there's not much here. So this could be thick skin. You want to know why? You know what the difference is between thick skin and thin skin histologically? In thick skin, the single greatest layer is the stratum corneum. In thin skin, it's the from epidermis to base that's thicker. So because this is such thick, I'm thinking it's probably thick skin, which means it's not going to have hair follicles, right? But you'll see a lot of sweat glands. And here, we'll show you some sweat glands.